Everybody, we are going to start this instruction course on tailored and sustainable approach to use of anti-VEGF in AMD. The first speaker is Dinesh Talwar. Dr. Dinesh Talwar doesn't need any introduction. He is a renowned vitreoretinal surgeon and is working in Center for Sight. And besides this, he is a very good speaker and a very good analyst. So, Dinesh Talwar.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I must say I owe a debt of gratitude to Professor Bipin Chandra, who was actually a patient of mine, but who very gently guided and encouraged me to continue my pursuit to try to achieve as successful a management of ARMD as possible. And he did that as long as he was alive. And I think whatever I know or do today in ARMD is a consequence of his pushing me and accepting whatever I offered to him with time, with changes in time. Therapy with anti-VEGFs is the mainstay of management for exudative ARMD, but the challenge is to optimize this management. And this optimization depends on the type of treatment. It could be lasers, pharmacotherapy, it could be the drug of use for treatment, and the schedules for retreatment. Laser is actually only for extrafoveal CNVs, but even today has a role in them. For the rest, photodynamic therapy is enjoying a resurgence, which is improving the requirement for that. And anti-VEGF, of course, stay the mainstay. The good thing is that we have the standard of care for anti-VEGF in the form of ranibizumab as the initial product, the Lucentis. We have something more than that in the form of Eylea, which is aflibercept. But we also have economical alternatives in the form of razumab, which is a biosimilar of ranibizumab, Zaltrap, which is the intravenous form of aflibercept, and Avastin and its biosimilars. The gold standard for management even today remains monthly treatment with Lucentis. Well, this is extremely intensive. It's exhausting for the patient and doctor. However, do not think it can't be done. There are patients who are one-eyed who will be willing to go through this month after month throughout their life, provided they are given intensive counseling, and especially if they are occupationally active and fit. So how have the advances in management protocols changed the current approach to management? First thing, you must know when to hold your hand. Who doesn't need treatment? It's an expensive treatment and you can save a lot of money for a patient. In patients who have a disciform scar like the ones you see over here, or geographic atrophy, foveal atrophy with no intraretinal, subretinal fluid on the OCT, they don't need any treatment, especially if the vision's now gone below 3/60 in the worst eye. It's not worth treating that anymore. But the more important thing is that non-progressive occult CNVs who have better than 6/12 vision, like you see here, again do not need treatment. And if you really want to see these studies, not a single study treats non-progressive occult or minimally classic CNV. The fine print is you treat any classic CNV, but only progressive occult or progressive minimally classic CNVs. Sometimes what looks like a scar ends up requiring treatment. What you see here are patients who had 6/24 vision, which is active vision, vision which is good for the patient, which you want to maintain. And now if these patients have cystic changes and an active CNVM, it still needs treatment. How do you decide how the patient will behave? Well, the EXCITE study showed us that 40% of patients could manage with quarterly treatment. Half of these patients actually did not need any treatment after initiation. However, the rest of the patients are those who will drop if the injection is not given earlier than that. So how do you decide what to give? Well, after you've given the first three injections, if your lesion is dry, These are the patients where I would actually put PRN treatment. If there's no recurrence for the next 3 months, continue monitor and extend, which means you slowly increase the period of follow-up from 4 to 6 weeks, 6 to 8 weeks, 8 to 10 weeks, etc. Till a maximum of 3 months. That 3 month follow-up is through life. It never stops. There is an alternative called treat and extend, which is becoming the norm for the Western population, but which I believe is probably for our patients, probably the best alternative if you have a one-eyed patient where you don't want to take any chances with a recurrence going out of hand. So this is just to show you a patient who got a small recurrence, was treated once, one injection, and for the next 6-7 months, no injections needed. Now you imagine you start putting this patient on a treat and extend, this patient would have had multiple injections for the in this same period. The second group of patients are those whom at month 3, after the 3 injections, are not dry. These are the patients where you would still continue monthly injections and see if they become dry in the next 3 months. If they become dry, it goes back to the PRN group, which we already described. If it does not dry, these are the patients who are now stable. And these are the patients whom you can now put into a treat and extend regime, where you see what is the maximum duration that this patient can do without an increase in the number of injections, and in which this lesion remains stable. So you go from 4 weekly to 6 weekly to 8 weekly to 10 weekly to 12 weekly. But if it comes back, and then start from, I would rather start from 4 weeks rather than 2 weeks before the previous time that he got the recurrence. Now, if the patient has no fluid, should we give any more injections? If this is the initial treatment, then you should have at least 2 consecutive OCTs with no fluid before you say, I don't need to treat anymore, and I'm putting on a PRN. But if this is a retreatment period, then I would just, the moment it becomes dry, I would stop the injections. I've realized more injections just means unnecessary more injections. It doesn't improve my responses. The last group of patients are those who at month 3 are still deteriorating or very active and not going down well. These are the patients where you should consider a shift to aflibercept or continue the monthly injections of Lucentis, and that will go on for the whole year. So what happens if you don't get a response to 3 loading doses? We have 2 alternatives. One is aflibercept, which is good for occult CNVM, and you have a combination therapy of photodynamic therapy with anti-VEGFs if you have a classic CNV. In classic CNV, it's very rare to have no response in 3 treatments. So if you have the initial non-responder or inadequate responder and the vision is better than 660, OCT is showing changes, I would continue to treat for the whole year. If the patient's vision starts deteriorating, the shift is warranted to one of the alternatives. But if the vision goes down below 660, to say 360 or so, and this is the worst eye and it's no longer giving you any response, maybe this is the time to stop treatment. When do we use in our practice aflibercept? Well, if you have a patient, this patient deteriorated from 6.9 to 6.18 on Lucentis monthly treatment, got one injection of aflibercept, the lesion dried almost completely. We then shifted him back to Lucentis as maintenance, and we've been able to keep him on Lucentis for maintenance, and once in a while, he needs an aflibercept injection. So for those who may be wondering, why not aflibercept only after this, you refer back to the VIEW trials, especially look at the VIEW 2 trial, and the answer is there. There's another group of patients who have this disproportionate hemorrhages or disproportionate exudates, which is where you have to rule out polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. And if this is the kind of picture they have, treat these patients with either aflibercept monotherapy, or you can give PDT with Lucentis, both of which work. For optimization of treatment, you need to optimize the frequency of monitoring. And the important thing is that 3-monthly monitoring is grossly inadequate for active disease. You need monthly follow-ups, and this alone will help you with the PRN treatment. And the guidelines for retreatment are the ones which are stringent, and they are what ensure that you manage to save your vision for many of your patients. So you can see these guidelines. Any change in vision for the negative, any new fluid, any persistent fluid which is not going away, increase in the central retinal thickness, any small macular hemorrhage, which you will pick up only when you do a good fundus examination when you're doing seeing your patient. And if the surgeon feels, no, there's something wrong, this is worsening, even that is enough of an indication for retreatment. As far as safety of the injections is concerned, well, the only thing I'd say is, in systemic safety, the only thing you have which is safe in the presence of a recent cardiac event or a recent stroke is 0.3 milligrams of Lucentis, which has been shown in the SAILOR trial. And we don't have a similar kind of trial for any of the other drugs. I'm just finishing now. As far as efficacy is concerned, the CAT trial showed that both Lucentis and Avastin work. But the fact was that if you see the results, you find the lesions were healing earlier with Lucentis than with Avastin. If you see the trend for PRN Lucentis as compared to Avastin, for the proportion of patients who lost more than 3 lines, at P less than 0.08, PRN Lucentis was better. In patients with occult CNV and polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy, it seems that aflibercept may do a better job. To summarize, ladies and gentlemen, anti-VEGF therapy can yield excellent visual outcomes, at least for the first 2-3 years. But in the long term, the vision results will slowly deteriorate. Keeping the retina dry seems to be important for best outcomes, though a little bit of fluid can be tolerated. Monthly therapy is very effective but costly, impractical in many cases, and may be associated with more atrophy. Therefore, these flexible dosing regimens, which allow personalized therapy to avoid both over and under treatment, are probably the way to go. Thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, I believe a tailored approach, seeing how your patient's responding, is probably the way to go and may help us to get the highest quality of care with the current methods available to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dinesh, for wonderful presentation. I think we'll take all the questions and answers. Question and answer in the last. So the next speaker is Bhuvan Channa, Dr. Bhuvan. Bhuvan is a vitreoretinal consultant in Bharti Eye Hospital in Delhi, and we are working together there. Bhuvan?
Thank you, sir, and good morning, everyone. So today I'll be presenting on the rationale of tailored approach in AMD. So in the previous presentation, as Dr. Dinesh mentioned, that every patient should have a individualized approach. I agree with that. And the gold standard being a monthly treatment, I'll just, my presentation is slightly against that, because the main reason for this I see is, if you can see in the abstract, is that the rising cost and the difficulty in affording the treatment. So because of that, I don't think that, as Dr. Dinesh said, that treat and extend is not the best alternative. But I think in our scenario, probably treat and extend would be the best alternative for the patient to come for a regular follow-up and treatment and do not stop the treatment in between. So I'll just start with my presentation. So these are the various options which were available. Pegabtanib is not used now. We have got bevacizumab, ranibizumab, and aflibercept for the treatment of anti-VEGF. I'll not go into the details of all these drugs. So this is the gold standard, but I don't think that it is possible in our country to continue with a fixed continuous regime in which we give monthly injections of Lucentis for the treatment of AMD. So these are the various trials which had been done. They're limited to 24 months of follow-up. They show that if ranibizumab is given every month, it shows that there is a dry OCT. But having 24 months, or having every month treatment throughout the life is very difficult for the patient. So why not treat everyone in a fixed monthly fashion? Because wet AMD is a heterogeneous disease. Every patient has got a different outcome, a different course of the disease. Many patients, they do well without monthly treatment. So probably in the end, we are over-treating patients. And recent research has shown that VEGF suppression also varies among different patients. So why a tailored approach? with chronic injections, repeated injections, we are also increasing the risks of the injections. It may lead to ocular side effects. It could lead to, there are known cases of glaucoma. It can lead to endophthalmitis. And also, it probably also causes an increased chances of the atrophy of the RP with repeated injections. And of course, there are also systemic effects which are associated with these anti-VEGF injections. So if all the patients were treated on a monthly regime, many of them would be overtreated. And overtreatment would lead to extra expense, which is the main reason in our country that patients do not come for a treatment. Large number of the patients will go untreated or partially treated due to poor sustenance. It is also inconvenient for the patient to come every month for, first of all, for a checkup, and then probably 3 weeks for a checkup, and every 4 weeks for an injection. And there is an increased cumulative risk of the anti-VEGF. So these are the three treatment regimes, the fixed continuous regime, and the second is the PRN as needed. When the swelling comes, we give the injection. And the third is the one which I'll be stressing is the treat and extend regime, which I think is the one which is suitable, and it should be individualized according to each patient. So I'll come to the second dosing regime, the PRN dosing, which is the pro-renata, the as-needed regime. It has got advantages over the fixed regime. It requires less frequent injections. Whenever there is a swelling, we repeat the injection. We give a 3 loading dose, and then we wait for the swelling to come, and then we give the injection. So there are less frequent visits. As compared to a fixed dose regime, it is more safe. It is more cost-effective. And we have the ability to identify the rare patients who may not even require further treatment. So this is a study, a Pronto study, which was done, which assessed the role of the PRN anti-VEGF dosing. It showed good effects over 2 years, and it also reduced the injection frequency from a mean of 1.6 injections in the first year to 4.3 injections in the second year. Whereas in a fixed regime, the patient would have been receiving 24 injections. So it appeared to achieve visual results similar to monthly dosing injections with fewer number of injections. But still it has some drawbacks. The patient still has to come every month. We have to look for the presence of macular edema. So the patient has to come every month. And whenever there is a macular edema, we inject. So there is always a risk if we are allowing the fluid to reaccumulate. And probably this can lead to long-term visual loss. It can cause damage to the photoreceptor and the RP layers. And there is also a risk of hemorrhage since we are allowing the macular edema to come again. And then we are treating. So this is a CAT trial where Dr. Dinesh also mentioned. I just wanted to mention that in this, they compared Avastin with Lucentis, and they said both of them, they have got equal results. And they also said that monthly treatment was slightly more superior to PRN therapy in the CAT therapy. And even the Ivan and the Manta study, they support this, that both Avastin and Lucentis, they have got almost equal efficacy when both of them were used, and the side effects are also same. So now I come to the third approach, which tries to overcome the drawbacks of both the initial regimes. The treat and extend regime is a tailored maintenance regime that helps to achieve optimal visual results. It consists of 3 loading doses, but once the patient has got a stable vision, absence of macular hemorrhage, and a dry OCT, we try to increase the interval of the injection to 6 weeks. So the patient after 3 doses will come at 6 weeks. At 6 weeks, if he has a dry macula, we still inject at 6 weeks. So we are trying to increase the interval from 4 to 6 weeks at a dry macula. If there is presence of any changes in the macula at 6 weeks, we will reduce the interval back to 4 weeks. So there will be a subset of patients who would require injections at every 4 weeks, but there is always a subset of patients who will be fine at 6 weeks. So we give an injection at 6 weeks. We again reassess the patient at 6 weeks. If the patient is dry again, we again repeat it at 6 weeks. But the next injection, then we'll increase the frequency to 8 weeks. So this is a mix and match type of a regimen. So when the patient comes at 8 weeks, we'll again do the OCT. And if it is dry, we try to increase it to 3 months. And at 3 months, we again assess the patient. So we can see the number of follow-up visits, the duration is increasing. The number of injections is also decreasing. So if a patient who requires more injection, we can decrease the frequency. And if a patient does not require injection, we can increase the frequency. So we do not wait for the macular edema to appear in this patient. If the OCT is dry at a particular follow-up, we still give the injection. So this is what I just said. If there are no changes, the interval to the next visit is extended to 8 weeks. And hence it is known as treat and extend. So we treat it and try to increase the frequency. So I've got few patients who are on aflibercept, and I'm giving them injection every, I've increased the duration, although they recommend 3 months, but I've increased the duration to 4 months. So you can see the number of injections in a year have just reduced to three. Three injections in a year is quite affordable for a patient as compared to a patient who is getting 8 or 9 aflibercept injections. However, if there is evidence of a renewed disease, as I said, we can just reduce the frequency and then schedule the injection accordingly. So each patient can have an individualized regimen according to his disease status. So the VIEW trial was the one which was done for aflibercept. In the VIEW 1 and VIEW 2, they gave 3 monthly injections, and then they used the treat and extend technique. So they found that fewer number of ILIA injections were required, and they helped in the maintenance of visual acuity and the change in the anatomical outcome. So both the trials were well-controlled head-to-head studies, and they evaluated the role of ILIA. And I know everybody knows that aflibercept is a well-accepted regimen, and they promote a treat and extend. So this is just showing the VIEW trial, which is done for the ILIA. So I'll just show it here. So this is the one they gave first 3 monthly injections, and then they extended it to 2 weeks. And similarly, if you can see here, you can extend the regimen at 2 weeks, extend it to 12 weeks. If there is a disease activity, we reduce it to 10 weeks. And if there is no disease activity, then we'll increase the frequency. So treat and extend is more predictable, and yet it is flexible. So it is a proactive dosing approach that helps to optimize vision while reducing the management burden on the patient as well as the surgeon. So it is more predictable, more flexible. We give 3 monthly injections again, then we increase it gradually by 2 weeks, every 2 months for the first year, and then we can probably increase it to every 3 months, which has been there in the literature, but I even have patients who have increased to 4 months and they're quite stable. And there is also no need for monitoring between the injections, so the patient does not have to come for frequent follow-ups and OCT in this regimen. So the take-home message in my presentation is a treat and extend approach, a tailored approach, is much superior in our country. In our country, there are people who have a difficulty in affording treatment. These injections are really expensive. Treat and extend is more predictable, more flexible. The cost of treatment is reduced. The number of follow-ups are reduced. We can have an individual regimen for each patient depending on his visual acuity and his OCT and his recurrence of the disease. And the overall cumulative risk for giving repeated injections are reduced. And in PRN, since we allow the macular edema to come back, there is a risk to the macula for a macular hemorrhage and loss, and this is not present in treat and extend. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Bhuvan. We'll take the questions in the end. So the next speaker is Dr. Girdhar. He doesn't need any introduction. He was president of Vitreoretinal Society of India. He's a great surgeon and a great human being.
Thank you, sir. Very nice. I think very important course, because it gives a lot of take-home messages. And I thought before I start, and the talk given by Bhuvan is a very important talk. What I tell my colleagues is that when you get a new patient with wet AMD, in the first year you study the case. The behavior, because we have a very small 20% or 15% of patients who, after the initial treatment, may not need injections for a long period of time. Therefore, the first year, you study the case, and if your patient is the type who needs more frequent injections, shift him to treat and extend. So in the second year, you shift him to treat and extend, because it has got its own advantages, which he has very beautifully highlighted. Now, I'll be talking on, actually, Dr. Azad has given me biosimilars of Avastin also, but I have not used the Zydex medicine much, and I do not know whether it's available now. So, Avastin cost and efficacy as monotherapy and tailored treatment. I thought I'll start this talk with this. I thought I'll just divert a little bit. I think this is the most important development in medical retina in the last 10 to 15 years. The development of the use of intravitreal bevacizumab, and it has helped millions of people across the world, especially the poor and the persons who are not having access to costly medical care. And this was because of Philip Rosenfield. I think it was a landmark development. And you must read this particular article, The Path to Intravitreal Bevacizumab, a logical decision based on scientific facts and clinical intuition. So what happened was, way back in 2004, when ranibizumab was undergoing the phase 2+ trials, and it would take another 2 years for the ranibizumab to come into the market, bevacizumab was about to get the FDA approval for use in colorectal cancer. And he realized that the molecules are nearly similar, that is bevacizumab and ranibizumab. So he got a permission from his university and his head of the department, that is Carmen Pugliafoto, and he initially used bevacizumab as an intravenous 5 mg/kg infusion, 3 infusions at 2 weeks interval. He treated 18 patients with wet age-related macular degeneration, and he followed up with time domain OCT, and he found a phenomenal result in all these patients at a time when we did not have much options in the treatment of wet age-related macular degeneration. So this was the landmark development as far as bevacizumab was concerned. So as he was driving home in his car one day, he thought, why not we remove the bevacizumab into a syringe, and why not we inject it intravitreally at a dose which ranibizumab is now undergoing the randomized trial. And at that moment, he met Carmen Pugliafoto, and he gave him permission and the ethical clearance in the university to try it only in patients of recalcitrant wet AMD at a time when PDT was the only treatment available to treat wet age-related macular degeneration. And the first patient he treated was in way back in 2005, nearly 14 years ago. And even today, most of us here are still using Avastin in spite of many, many issues which I'll come to later. But nonetheless, it's a very efficacious drug. And this patient was again a recalcitrant case, and he found phenomenal results with even just with the first injection of bevacizumab. We published last year at a time when there was a lot of issues last year, year before last year, when there were a lot of issues with Avastin in our country. There was a DGCA problem. We had a lot of meetings, etc. At that time, I asked one of my colleagues, why not we just analyze the real-world safety profile? And we analyzed 3,806 injections in 1,761 patients over a period of many years. And we found that Avastin is a very safe drug. There are hardly any side effects. Among the ocular side effects was endophthalmitis in 3 eyes, that is 0.08%. That's a very low incidence, comparable to any international data on use of intravitreal injections. The increase in intraocular pressure was very minimal. It was only 0.9%. And the total number of intravitreal injections, mostly more in DME than in AMD, but a large number of patients resulting in about 3,806, and the low grade, of which one patient required vitrectomy, but none of the patients lost their vision. Coming to the efficacy of the drug, this is a patient who has been on multiple ranibizumab, Eylea, etc. for many years. And finally, he is a one-eyed patient, so he was reluctant to have Avastin. But finally, he told me, doctor, now the other drugs are getting a little tachyphylaxis. I'm now prepared for Avastin. And it worked like magic for him. During the last 1 year, he has received very few injections. Even the fibrovascular PED has collapsed a bit. The fluid has reduced, and he is now receiving regular Avastin. And now the need for Avastin is far less than other drugs that he had earlier. And he still maintains a visual acuity of nearly 6/9 in that eye. Therefore, Avastin is definitely a very efficacious drug in most clinical situations. Now, this is one of my oldest patients on treat and extend therapy with Avastin in both the eyes. In the right eye, she has received 26 intravitreal Avastin injections. Best corrected visual acuity even now is about 6/15. And in the left eye, she has received 21 injections in the last 4 years. Again, the visual acuity is maintained about 6/18, 6/12. Very regular patient, no side effects, no inflammation, no complications, still no hardly any tachyphylaxis. Therefore, there are a large set of patients who are benefiting with Avastin. Now, this is the CAT trial, which he has already told you. The most important message from the CAT trial is that at the end of 5 years, 50% of the patients at 20/40 are better visual acuity, and nearly 10% of the patients with vision of 20/20. And most importantly, the CAT trial told us that treatment with anti-VEGF is far better than the natural cause of the disease in wet age-related macular degeneration. Economics, it all depends on your hospital. Now, in my hospital, 8,000 5,000, 2,500. We have got three slabs. The poor patients, we do it for 2,500. We do it for 5,000 for patients who need more number of injections. We do it for 8,000 for leg patients with vascular occlusions, etc. The need for injections are far less. So the cost of treatment is far less than other drugs. Now, I need to compare Avastin with biosimilar, with all the problems again with Rasumab, which has now cropped up recently. Which is safer, Avastin or Rasumab? It's a debatable question. I feel Avastin is safer than Rasumab. The most of the issues with Avastin have been because of poor eliquoting, etc. I don't think, or some sort of, I do not know, some industry problems. But nonetheless, Avastin is a safe drug even today. And in our institution, we use it. And recently, you can see here the $17 billion is what the United States saved. This is an article written by Philip Rosenfield in 1 year. Thanks to this great drug. Biosimilars, Avastin, Roche, is the patent is finishing this year, and there are a lot of companies which are working on intravenous, Biocon India, Reddy Laboratories, etc. In my Hawa hospital, I just analyzed, we are using in the last 6 months, you can see here, Avastin 799. Therefore, Avastin, of course, Accentrix and Lucentis are the same. But nonetheless, even today, the number of inpatients receiving bevacizumab is far more than other drugs. Thank you all. I think the message is very clear.
Thank you very much, Girdhar, for a wonderful presentation. Very nice, very informative. We'll have a discussion in the end. May I have the next speaker, Debudulal. Debudulal is from Desha Eye Hospital, and he's a veterinary consultant. And here is Debudulal.
Very good morning to all, and I'd like to thank Azad sir for this opportunity here this morning. I'll be speaking on the Disha experience of Rasumab analysis of more than 1,000 cases. So we don't have any financial interest in this. It's not moving. The essence of today's presentation is best summed up by Azad sir in his abstract, where he mentions the rising cost of medicines is a prohibiting factor for availing quality healthcare for large population of our country. And more than that, AMD, which can lead to blindness in a majority of our patients if left to nature. So today, with the introduction of anti-VEGFs, the patients are better off, but the issue here is again the financial condition of the patients and the cost of the drugs. Today, when we talk about Rasumab, we have to talk about it in the backdrop of this advisory note from the Vitreoretinal Society of India, which mentions that batch 52 is better not used. But is it a batch-related issue, or is it a Rasumab issue that only time will tell us? Now, let's go back in time to the year 2013. The total number of intravitreal injections in Disha Eye Hospitals across all branches was 15,232. And this comprised of Avastin, Lucentis, and IVTA. Moving on to 2016, the number dropped to 6,534 because we received an advisory note from the health department of the state of West Bengal mentioning about the cluster endophthalmitis cases of Avastin due to Avastin, and we were forced to stop using Avastin because of governmental pressure. Moving on to 2018, the number has marginally increased to 8,756, and here we have 4,258 eccentrics, we have 434 Lucentis, both are same basically, Rasumab 2637, Eylea 156, IVTA is 1271, and the total is 8756. Now we have used from 15th June 2016 to 15th December 2018 a total of 4517 Rasumab injections. And this we started after receiving this the drug controller's permission. After Rasumab received drug controller's permission. But the question here again is, what is the number of patients who were advised anti-VEGF in Disha and beyond Disha across the country and who could not take an injection? So for this, we have to look at the GDP data. The 2018 GDP, urban GDP of our country is $3,000, and compare it to the rural GDP, it's $950. In Disha, the innovator brand costs 19,700 to the patient, whereas Rasumab, we inject at 10,000 to the patient. So Disha is basically a practice that is based mostly in the semi-urban and the rural areas. Only four of our branches out of the 13 branches are basically within the city limits of Kolkata. So this was a retrospective evaluation of all eyes with Vet AMD that received Resumab. And it's important to mention here that we offer a bouquet of all anti-VEGF to the patient, and we don't decide for the patient which anti-VEGF he or she is going to take. So patients were given the discretion to choose between anti-VEGFs, and this data includes data that was retrospectively evaluated from patients' medical records. So the history was taken into account, comprehensive clinical examination, the DFA and the SDOCT. ICG was done in selected cases. And the examination schedule that we follow is basically the baseline examination followed by 3 to 4 days post-injection, and then 4 weeks, and then every month the patients are called back. Now, we basically looked at the safety to observe any reactions and the effectiveness, whether there was any increase in the best corrected visual acuity and whether there was a mean decrease in the central macular thickness. So cutting across indications, we actually did 554 wet AMD eyes, and there were 129 treatment naive cases. The rest were basically changeovers from the other anti-VEGF agents, and a substantial number of them received more than one or two injections. Now, looking at the morbidity, we have had four patients since 2016 to December last year with CVA who developed CVA, and this was between 1 and 6 months of receiving the last injection of Resumab. Of course, there were other ocular side effects, mild ocular pain in 97 eyes, burning sensation 104 eyes, transient blurring of vision 122 eyes, AC cells in 7 eyes, hyphema 2 eyes, vitreous hemorrhage in 2 eyes, RP rip in 6 cases, and vitreous cells in 1 eye. And this patient went on to need intravitreal antibiotics and did well subsequently. Now, if you look at the central macular thickness reduction, it was fair across all groups, and of course in the wet AMD group also it was doing good. And so also the visual acuity improved in these patients of wet AMD. The IRF and the SRF also reduction was noted. So now let's look at a few cases. Well, AMD, as we all know, is not an open and shut kind of a scenario where you give one or two injections and everything is good thereafter. There are, of course, one or two cases who can have this kind of a result, but mostly it is not that. So let's look at this scenario. PED with some SRF. This was in 2017, January. After the first injection of Resumab, some reduction. After the second injection of Resumab, the patient appeared little better as far as the vision was concerned, but the RP was looking troublesome. And soon enough, the patient came back with a RP rip, and patient never came back to us again, cursing me. So let's look at this scenario. This is a patient who had received two injections of Avastin elsewhere, and when he came to us, vision was 624. So we did a DF and a ICG, and we asked him to undergo a combined therapy of PDT and Lucentis, and he did undergo. Vision went up, and subsequently patient again had a relapse, as was expected. And now the patient asked us that it's impossible for me to continue with the other brands, so the only option I have is Resumab, which is relatively cheaper. This is a retired physician. He's 89 years old currently, and his story, he's a one-eyed person at that, and his story started in 2008, when he had an IPCV, and he's had 49 injections so far. He's had two PDTs done so far, and these 49 injections are cutting across all kinds of anti-VEGFs, starting from Avastin to Eylea to Resumab to Lucentis. So the question here is the cost. So basically for the last 6 months, he's been doing good, and he's 636, and he has this amount of vision to guide him through the rest of his life. So another scenario, this is a patient, this is a 70-year-old lady at 2014 who presented with a RP, RIP, and CNVM. So she was not receptive to any kind of cajoling and coaxing, and she did not go in for an anti-VEGF at that point of time. The other eye vision was good, and she was happy with that. This is following up to 2017, when she was 6'9 in the left eye. And then in 2017, July, 1 month after the previous checkup, She developed this huge PED, extra large PED with SRF, and she was asked to undergo ILEA. She refused, and soon enough, within a couple of weeks, she came back to us with this RP rip. This was a spontaneous RP rip that developed, and this time she was more receptive to our pleas, and she underwent a couple of Lucentis at that point of time, and she was doing good. But now, for the last year and a half, she's been on Resumab. She's received 7 Resumabs, and this is her condition in December last year. So she's maintaining 6/18 vision. And the story is, continues like this with other patients who've received, other anti-VEGF at different points of time. This is another patient who initially had received Excentrix, then just vanished and landed up last year with this recurrence. And then after 3 Resumab, is currently doing 6/12, still with some fluid there. So the conclusion today that we have to come at is, there are no RCT or head-to-head studies comparing Resumab with the other agents. And the challenge ahead is to provide a safe drug that is effective as well as that is safe for the patient. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Deb Dulal. And the next presentation is Dr. Sobhit Chawla, and everybody knows him. He is now the current president of Vitreoretinal Society of India. He has a maximum experience on aflibercept. So he's going to speak on aflibercept cost and the efficacy.
Had very interesting presentations in this session, thanks to Dr. Azad's vision about this session, I must say, and very relevant to the current scenario where we are all deciding what agent to use. We are restricted by administrative and government norms, safety issues. So I've been fortunate enough to have tried aflibercept in a large number of my cases, because maybe we are doing more frequent ICG, and in any suspicious case of CNVM, we do it. And we've been finding in our series at our center, out of the referred patients, nearly 50 to 55% patients having some element of polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. So we are dealing with a drug which is more of a pan anti-VEGF rather than just targeting VEGF. It works on both sides of the VEGF dimer, and it has shown a proven supremacy in its suppression of VEGF. It has also shown longer time for CNV recurrence to take place after treatment. So in nutshell, it is a cost effective by reducing direct non-medical costs, where we are dealing with fewer number of injections. And this is the view one extension, which shows visual acuity gains were sustained to week 212 with modified quarterly aflibercept dosing. And so proactive regimen and its potential to reduce the number of injections and the treatment burden is what we all are trying to focus on. A proactive treat and extend regimen with reduced number of visits should make it easier for patients to manage travel to and from the clinic, lesser visits, lesser burden to the patient and the family, help ease some of the burden on the clinic and improve clinic flow, and also provide reassurance that treatment, if delayed, will help to alleviate the stress experienced by some patients about treatment delays because of various issues like insurance clearance, etc. So Trek showed us that ranibizumab treat and extend achieved similar outcomes to monthly ranibizumab in 2 years with a mean of about 18.6 injections, even when treat and extend was followed. And it was quite similar to monthly regimen. Aflibercept, around 50% of patients were maintained with quarterly or less frequent dosing beyond year one. One of my cases shows you a case in the initial ICG, we didn't pick up the polyp, but in the later ICG, we picked up the polyp post-treatment. We repeat the ICG normally after 3 months, and you see this polypoidal area highlighted, though there was some evidence here in the initial OCT. For aflibercept over 1 year, only eyed patient, visual acuity 6-9. Patient is on a treat and extend regimen, and though looking at Dr. Giridhar's presentation, we have not used Avastin for the last 5 years. I'm tempted to restart using it now in these cases and further reduce. Another patient who had only eyed, senior lawyer who had undergone right eye PDT, eye was scarred, counting finger vision, left eye, 2 PDTs, and 6-9 vision, this huge branching vascular network, which you see with the high potential of developing sudden submacular hemorrhage and losing all potential of vision. Initiated his therapy in January 2016. We are nearly completing 5 years now of ILIA therapy in our patients, I think since the 4.5 years since its introduction into India. And there was a little setback here in March 2017. Otherwise, he was maintaining a vision of 6-9 with repeated therapy, and he's taking about 2 to 3 injections a year now. It's he maintains in December 2000 6-9 vision with this clinical picture. I think it's a very gratifying result in an only eyed patient where we are looking at the potential risk of a sudden submacular hemorrhage and total loss of vision. We all have operated, we all have seen such cases. So 42 to 50% patients in ALTAIR of patients extended to 12 weeks and beyond at their last interval beyond 52 weeks. And the data has been from other studies also. So a pragmatic, practical approach, I would say, when you do OCT and you find features suggestive of PCV, go ahead, do an ICG. Positive features on ICG, which is in a large number of cases, as Dr. Giridhar would also testify. I think he has the largest series in the country on PCV. Initiate aflibercept therapy, load 3 doses, and treat and extend on a quarterly basis. So we are entering an era of new posology of aflibercept in neovascular AMD, reflects its suitability for proactive treat and extend regimen, allowing extension of treatment intervals in 2 to 4 weekly increments in year one. And we offer our patients the best possible costing for aflibercept. If they are on long-term treatment, we just do it on an injection basis. We don't even charge anything for the services. And I know it's off the record, I can't say on a podium, but we don't hesitate if we have 2 patients in sharing the injection, because the doses is enough for 2 patients and cut down the cost further for the patient. Thank you very much, Dr. Azad, and everybody for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, Sobhit. We have a keynote address, and Dr. Daniel Ahmad, he is from Austria, Vienna, and I would like to invite him to speak on relationship between Drusen characteristic and type 2 macular neovascularization in AMD. So, Dr. Ahmad.
So, dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this introduction. My name is Dr. Daniel Ahmed from Vienna, Austria. It's a pleasure for me to be here today. Really great meeting, great session. But unfortunately, I have to tell you, my contribution to this session is limited as a talk just about diagnostics, not about anti-VEGF. But anyhow, it will tell you as well a very nice story. So, coming about Drusen. Drusen were first described in the year 1855 by Franciscus Donders. He was a Dutch ophthalmologist, and shortly afterwards, a German ophthalmologist called Heinrich Müller termed this as drusen. And drusen is the German term for geots. There are various types of drusen, something like soft, hard, cuticular, and collet drusen, pachy drusen. They are between the RP and Bruch's membrane, and subretinal drusen deposits are in the subretinal space. Of course, you're familiar with the RS classification. It's quite common, but there was a new classification system introduced by Spade in the last year with predictive capabilities regarding future cause disease. And he implemented the term macular neovascularization instead of choroidal neovascularization, because type 3 CNV might never involve the choroid. Coming to the incidence of pure type 2 macular neovascularization, when it comes to the incidence, is always the Jung paper cited, coming from year 2014. And by using only FA, they had an incidence of 12%. And by combining FA and OCT, increased the incidence to 9%. And then there is the Nizam paper published in year 2016, and they used FA and OCT, and they had an incidence rate of 0.8%. And 7 of these 8 eyes, so 88%, had subretinal drusen deposits. Coming to our study, the study protocol was to assess the relationship between drusen characteristics and pure type 2 macular neovascularization. We did a retrospective evaluation between June 2008 and December 2017. All of the patients were initially diagnosed by Professor Ansari Charisse from Macular Unit of Vienna, Austria. And we compared the drusen subtypes of type 2 to mixed type macular neovascularization. All patients were imaged by the Heidelberg Spectralis device, working on 870 nanometers wavelength. Every patient had an OCT, infrared, blue peak autofluorescence, fluorescein angiography, and ICJ. And regarding grading, we had drusen over 63 microns, smaller than 63 microns, subretinal drusen deposits, cuticular drusen, and pachy drusen. Exclusion criteria were subfoveal atrophy and fibrosis, and we did a mask immunization by 2 instructed readers. And this is the first interesting result, the demographic data, because there was a male preponderance going on in the type 2 group, which is quite atypical for late stage AMD. Now they choose the MNV subtypes. Of course, type 1 was the largest portion, and type 2 had an incidence of 3.3%, and mixed type of 6.1%. Now I want to show some examples. This 81-year-old female patient with a pure classic type 2 on the right eye. You can see here with the white arrowheads, drusen over 63 microns, and with the black arrowheads, subretinal drusen deposits. Here on the ICJ, pure classic lesion and FA. You can see here the subretinal drusen deposits at the fellow eye and drusen over 63 microns. So this is one case. Another case with a mixed type. You can see the white arrowheads, drusen over 63 microns. And as well on the fellow eye, drusen over 63 microns on both eyes. Now here, interesting case, is stereo sky appearance and FA, and this sawtooth-shaped elevations of the RP. Same thing on the other eye. So cuticular drusen on both eyes. Now here, type 2 macular neovascularization, classic one. But here, you can't hardly find any drusen, this patient. And something like this was quite common in the type 2 group. So the probability of getting no drusen was significantly higher in the type 2 group compared to the mixed type group. And drusen over 63 microns were significantly higher in the mixed type group compared to the type 2 group. What you can see here, the bar graphs quite nicely. And as well in the contralateral eye, same thing. And all of this information were highly significant. All drusen phenotypes occurred less likely in the pure type 2 group compared to the mixed type group. And drusen over 63 microns were more frequently identified in the mixed group. And a thinner subfoveal coil thickness was detected in elderly patients with STD compared to patients without STD. And there was a statistical tendency towards male preponderance in the type 2 group. concluding that type 2 MNB most infrequently seen together with extracellular deposits typical for AMD. And this information is based on a detailed image acquisition analyzation over a 10-year observation period, and different biological pathways related to type 2 lesions might be discussed. But anyhow, multimodal imaging, high-resolution imaging tools like SWEPS, OCT, and EDI will contribute to an even better understanding in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Daniel. Now it gives me pleasure to invite Professor Rajvardhan Azad, the chairman of the session and who has conceived this beautiful session. What should be the pragmatic approach to anti-VEGF for all as a sustainable option? A very important and relevant topic to our Indian scenario.
Thank you, Sobhit. Basically, what I'm going to talk in this presentation is how to go about what we should do, you know, what can we do. We have had the 3-4 presentation here, and my focus is on the cost. See, we are all for the patient, and if the patient pocket cannot allow, so we can't help. So that's why, you know, if we have some a kind of a protocol which can also make the patient comfortable and, of course, make us also comfortable. See, we have to understand what is our milieu, means what is our population. Patients, you know, in the rural areas, they can't afford the treatment. They have to, you know, reconcile to the fact that the affordability is not there and it's difficult for them to carry out the treatment. You must have seen lots of these patients get lost in the follow-up, and that is because of the financial reasons. At the same time, we have to also see that the protocol which we are providing to the patient is also efficacious. We can't just focus on the cost factor. We have to see that it is efficacious also. And at the same time, it should be sustainable, because AMD is a disease which, you know, related to aging. So as long as the patient lives, the disease will be there. And so is diabetic retinopathy. So we have to have some kind of treatment protocol which is sustainable. And of course, as I told you, that my focus on the economics, that the patient should be able to afford. If the patient is not able to afford, what is the use of the treatment, or what is the use of the new drug? So how should we go about? I think we should examine the efficacy of all the anti-VEGF. That was the reason why I had all these presentations. We had a presentation on aflibercept. We had a presentation on Avastin. We had a presentation on Rezumab, to make you understand what is the efficacy of these drugs. So that's very important. And then look into the cost factor. I'll just show you, I have two PowerPoints in which I'll show you what is the cost factor which is involved. And then the other thing is, look for the compliance. You know, we talk of treat and extend, we talk of PRN, we talk of this monthly treatment. So, but then the compliance of the patient has to be there. You want that the patient should come to you at the desired follow-up time, and at the same time, you also want that patient should not lose his vision because of some injections which is missing. So in fact, I have put a question to the panel related to this, that would you like to fix your mind on a particular regime of treatment, or you would like to customize it according to the need of the patient? So that is another thing. And then, of course, the ease of follow-up we have to see. So if you want to, I think Sobhit and Bhuvan and all those speakers who are here, I think Girdhar is not here. I want to, Girdhar is here, yes. So I want to devise a protocol of different arms. I'll give you two PowerPoint presentations showing the what is the cost involved. Can we combine, you know, like aflibercept with this Excentrix? As a just now I had a talk with, I was talking to Sobhit, and he said that after, say, 10 injections, or after, say, 4 injections of aflibercept, the guy gets fed up because he has too much of money he has to shed out of his pocket. So can he continue on the eccentrics or for that matter on Avastin? So we need to have these arms. And then what is the arm cost? If suppose in AMD we have 9 injections, and if 9 injections with aflibercept, what is the cost? 9 injections with eccentrics, what is the cost? And if we combine, then what is the cost? So define the cost of the different arms. And then we will make a multicentric large cohort and long duration trial to conduct field trial. Why I'm saying this? Because to make any clinical trial effective, all these are the basic parameters. It should be multicentric, it should be large cohort, and it should be long duration. By large cohort, I don't mean 10,000, because that will not be possible. But at least 100 patients, maybe at least 500 patients. So that is important. We know that eccentrics, early gain is by eccentrics. So you can see here that 3 months, 18% improvement in the vision is there. If it is 15 letter and 10 letter gain is 37%. And until 3 years, this is sustained. So initial gain is by eccentrics. Now let's see the logistics. This is the logistics you can see here as far as the cost is involved. The safety of these drugs, you know, they are all safe. Biosimilar, we don't have the enough data about the efficacy of the bevacizumab biosimilar. But I believe all these biosimilar, all this bevacizumab, the eccentrics aflibercept and this bevacizumab or Avastin, they all have been efficacious. And see this, you know, if you see the cost per injection, this is the cost of all these drugs. And of course, this is the patient, you know, support program, which is only available with this eccentrics at this point of time. But the other drugs are there, you know, and this is the average cost. I'm talking of the average cost. Some, you know, centers may be, you know, charging 60 or 65. Some centers here may be charging 30,000. But that is the average cost which is in the hospitals. Now, this I have computed for you if we have a combo treatment. This is just to give you an idea about the different arms, what could be the different arms. And I'm talking of 9 injections in a year. If we have a 9 inject, this is the, you know, the cost of the treatment does not include just the injection cost. It includes the cost of the procedure, includes the diagnostic per year for at nine visits, and then diabetic and other medication if patient is a diabetic, and retinal treatment cost per year, the cost of the laser if it is needed, and the consultant fees, and altogether you can see if it is only eccentrics, this comes to somewhere around 2,66,200. If it is eccentrics with bevacizumab, if we combine the two, means 3 injections with for early gain and 6 injections for maintenance, if we do that, the cost will come down to 1,62,000. And then if it is eccentrics with biosimilar, means if rezumab is there with eccentrics, then the cost will be somewhere around 2,21,000. And you must be wondering why it is more, because eccentrics has got a, you know, the program, patient support program. So that is the one advantage with the eccentrics. And then if you see here, the ranibizumab biosimilar, like rezumab, it is comes around 1,95,200. But this is the cost. By the cost, I cannot, you know, tell you that with 9 injections, we will get the same effect what we will get with monotherapy of with one drug, without combination. So for that, we need to have a trial. So what do we see? We see here that anti-VEGF is, of course, the mainstay of treatment. And the anti-VEGF was started somewhere around 2006, 2007. We all used before that. There was no anti-VEGF. We were only doing PDT, right, left, and center. And then the most important thing is the safety concern. We have the safety concern for most of the drugs right at this point of time, but we do not have for the newer drugs, biosimilars, which are coming in the market. And then the main problem is with the cost. Because if you, you know, give aflibercept to a patient for a long time, say 9 injections, it's very difficult. And similarly is for the eccentrics. So the cost of treatment is the main reason, you know, for which the patient withholds himself. Many patients says, abhi paisa nahi hai mere paas mein. Hum abhi jayenge 6 hafte ke baad aayenge, 8 hafte ke baad aayenge, and he can't come to the follow-up. So that's a very, prohibiting factor. And then, of course, it's very important to see the patient compliance, whether he can come or not, because he's coming from a far distance. So we have to make allowance for that. That's what I say, that rather than talking of PR and treatment, monthly treatment, or, you know, for that matter, treat and extend treatment, we should customize it according to the need of the patient, because that's very important. So I suggest, I think Girdar is here, and Sobit is here, myself, and some other people, we can join together and have a kind of a multi-centric trial. And, we can have eccentrics 3. This is just a, suggestion. We can have 3 aflibercept also, depending upon what kind of disease is there. If PCV is there, we can, of course, start with the aflibercept. But if the non-PCV AMD is there, we can use eccentric injections. So, and then we can sustain it with, rezumab or bevacizumab or any other biosimilar injections. The basic idea is to see the cost of the 9 injections. At the same time, we have to see that the combination of drug is effective for the patient. So this is just a suggestion, and we'll, sit together and we'll see how we can work on this. Thank you very much for kind attention. I think rather than taking questions, I have, from the presentation, I have, taken out some clues. Here, I think Dinesh is not here. So, the first, issue is about how many of us differentiate between classic and non-classic CNVM at this point of time? Will that? Do you differentiate?
I definitely differentiate from the point of view that I like to, in all type 1 lesions, I like to do an ICG just to exclude PCV with the high percentage of cases which we see in Asian eyes. What do you feel, Giri, about this?
Do you make a distinction between classic and non-classic?
Yeah, I make a distinction between classic occult and the new aneurysmal dilatations. Basically because I think from the patient's point of view, prognostication, etc., I think there is a lot of information that we can give to the patient. Number one is occult doesn't progress very fast. The patients may have good vision and it doesn't progress, whereas classic progresses very fast. So if you have a patient with a classic with a 6-9 vision, I think there is an urgency in initiating treatment. But if you have an occult with 6-9, probably even if he comes after 1 month or 1.5 months, his vision may remain 6-9. So it's very important to say, from the patient point of view, prognostication, I think it's very important to initially differentiate between the subtypes and explain to the patient the seriousness of the disease.
So does it make difference in the the drug you are using or the protocol, does it make difference
in
that?
Classic and occult, I don't think there is any difference in the drug that we use. But probably if you have a polypoidal or aneurysmal dilatation, then there is a difference in the.
Debdeal, what is your opinion?
We counsel the patient depending on the ICG and the DFA also. So not it's not the OCT only that counts.
Yeah, I think differentiation was really essential in the era of PDT. We now differentiated more it for ourselves so that we know what the outcome of the disease is, because both of them have a different course. But yeah, the treatment almost remains same for both of them. So, but differentiating is still important, but more for us, I think, for the course.
boss is coming. The boss is coming.
Dinesh. So we are discussing about your presentation and we are talking about classic and non-classic, but we have got the opinion from everybody and I believe you will also agree with this. Basically, classic and non-classic differentiation is for ourselves, for understanding what kind of disease the patient is having, what kind of prognosis the patient is carrying, and maybe in certain times, what kind of drug we should use. So for all these situations, we the club, but for all other purposes, practical purposes like institution of treatment and therapy, I think doesn't make a difference, right? So, yes. I think another question to the panel is that suppose somebody, you are injecting and he has been quiet for 6 months. I'm talking of AMD. So when you are starting the treatment again, what regimen you follow?
So any recurrence I give, that's what I said, in any recurrence I give one injection only. I do not give two, which I used to do before. When I started off, we used to give two injections. That means one more after it was dry. But I realized all that was happening was I was giving an extra injection, but the recurrence rates were not changing. So therefore, now I've gone back to just you treat. If it resolves, you leave, then put it back on monitor. If it's not resolved, you give the second injection.
So it's a bend towards PRN.
I think a very important question, but I think I slightly differ with it because I think treat and extend is more important. We should not, even if it is dry, we should not leave the patient
for...
I wanted time
to respond to
No,
so you want to start it right
Now,
but if you, otherwise maybe it comes as part of the patient.
Fine, but because if a patient is dry, still dry, so I don't want to leave the patient for 6 months to wait for the fluid to come and then give an injection.
No,
probably
I mean...
But we can increase the duration to probably, I say, 8 weeks. And then
I had 8 minutes, so I left this topic and for you to push it further on along this line. Now, let me answer this. Now, let me answer this in a little more detail. When you how many patients become dry after 3 injections? Okay. No. 40%. Okay. Now, of these 40%, half, that is 20%, will not need any injection in the next 2 years. Okay? Now, supposing these dry lesions you were treating by treat and extend, in 2 years you've given them 10 injections. Consider the burden to society. Consider the burden to an individual who did not need any treatment. Okay? So, first group is these 20% who did not need any treatment. The second group is who actually needed only once in 3 months treatment. And this is what the EXCITE study showed. That these 40% patients, these 20% to ho gaye jinko chahiye hi nahi tha. Wo to 3 monthly is too much for them. But the 20% who are left over are adequately treated with just one injection in 3 months. And you're now, what are you doing? No, I'm going to give it 4 weeks. Now I'm going to give it 6 weeks. Now I'm going to give it 8 weeks. You actually again given an extra 6 injections. Not needed. Now let's see the third the ones who did not respond. There, I also accept. The patient has reached a stable lesion. It's not a dry lesion. There is some fluid, but it's not increasing. Now you want to see how much can you increase this without getting a recurrence. This is where treat and extend should be used. The Western world is saying treat and extend for dry lesions. The safest lesions, which easily can be managed by PRN, you want to treat by treat and extend. Secondly, what is the basis of this? The basis of this, and you should see, their milieu and your milieu. Injection is free. Injection is free. The cost, the trouble is all of coming and going. That is gone. Once in our setup, the patient pays for the injection, 30,000 extra he's paying for the injection, and you say, wo 2,000 mein bacha deta hun, ki usko visit jo extra lag rahi hai. Uski 10 visits bhi extra laga doge, tab bhi injection, ek injection ki cost nahi niklegi. Ek injection ki cost nahi bachegi. He is better off, the results would be better off for PRN. The amount of over-treatment is too much. And that is why in patients who are stable, there, yes, it makes sense. There you try to extend.
Thank you, Dinesh.
Thank you, sir. I think we need to have a new protocol for our patients. It should be soon.
I think you missed my presentation. You did? Cost valley, yes. Well, no, what I'm planning is, you know, that we should have a combination of treatment to reduce the cost. At the same time, it should be effective. So we need to define the arms, different arms, you know, and then the cost of the arm. Like if 9 injections we are giving in a year, so what will be the cost if a single monotherapy is there, and what will be if combination of drug is there, and then if we have a kind of a trial that will help us, you know, in the long run. The other thing was the different protocol regimes are there, like treat and extend monthly, and then PRN. So would you like to customize for the patient rather than you fix that this is my treatment regimen? So this is more or less customized, no?
Customized.
You are not doing.
It's customized to each patient.
Yeah, that's what I'm
saying.
For
somebody, it may be 2 months.
Yes,
you would
that's what I was so coming to. The
I
next.
We can have something in between PRN and treat and extend.
So this is what it is.
Yeah.
It is PRN plus monitor and extend.
So as soon as we have the slightest doubt of a minimal edema happening,
yes.
We can
that's
treat.
That's why I said the, in the
so
end.
So we can have a treat and extend with regular follow-ups.
Yeah. So that is what this monitor and extend is. The moment you get the first sign of disease, treat.
Acha. Other thing is like, you know, you missed the Girdhar presentation. He made a very, you know, wonderful presentation about bevacizumab. And in a very large series of patients, retrospective study and very large series. So he showed, you know, the efficacy of bevacizumab. And he showed it's wonderful. It works very well. Would you like to combine Excentrix with bevacizumab? Like initial 3 dose you would like to give with the Excentrix. That's what I'm saying, cost issue.
For now, ultimately, you know, the fact is, use of bevacizumab is something in which I'm not comfortable because even though my source is reliable, because the government does not permit it.
Just a moment. Forget aside the government.
If the government says go ahead and do it, if the government says go ahead and do it, the cost of bevacizumab is 800 rupees per injection. Cost. Okay? Why do you have to take 8,000 rupees more? I mean, if you're so bothered about about your patient and if you're so altruistic, give it for 1,000 rupees.
Hello?
Take 25% profit.
Okay.
If you're not so bothered, take it for 2,000 rupees. Who is giving for 2,000?
No, I'm not talking.
The point I'm trying to make is, sir, we keep, and I tell you what, now this is something I'm calling a spade, because we all say for our patients, you know, they can't afford it, we want to give Avastin. But are you giving Avastin for 2,000 rupees? You are giving it for 10,000 rupees, 8,000 rupees. That means we are actually trying to see what maximizes our profit. It's a very strong statement to make, but the fact is we are doing it for our profit, not for the patient. So let's be very clear on this. If we are doing it for the patient, yes, Avastin is available for 2,000. We should push the government that it should be available for all subsidized patients at that level.
Can you say add one thing?
Please.
If Avastin is approved, we can also give the loading dose of Avastin.
Sure.
Why any
monthly Avastin is better than PRN Lucentis. That the CAT trial showed.
So that's what I'm saying. We can, you know, work on different arms.
Yes.
And calculate the cost also, and then see the efficacy. We need to have a field trial. I'm not just saying, you know,
The itch for Avastin is not the drug. The drug is safe. The drug is good. The drug works. So there are enough trials to show that. The hitch is the Indian government.
No,
and
that.
Also spurious drug in India.
See, that.
There is a problem.
That you can take care of with your. Now,
because
the
not
genesis of the spurious drug is the desire for profit. Again, if you insist on the proper distributor to give you, you get it at a higher cost. You want to bring that cost by
2,000, 3,000 down, you get a spurious
stroke. I think we'll close here. Is there any one question from the audience? So I think we'll close the session here and thank everybody for having come here, and thanks a lot. Can all the presenters be here? You know, we can take a picture.